We explored the structure and some properties of atoms in the Foundation 1 tutorial. This time, we'll see how atoms can achieve maximum stability. Most atoms are most stable when their outer or valence electron shell is filled. This is why we saw that electronegativity doesn't apply to atoms in the far right column of the periodic table. Those atoms already have a full valence electron shell and thus maximum stability. They don't attract extra electrons. For atoms that don't already have a full valence shell, there are two ways for an atom to achieve maximum stability by filling its valence electron shell. Both ways are through bonding. Bonds form molecules, which consist of two or more atoms. A molecule is defined as the smallest piece of a substance that still has characteristics of that substance. For example, we can't divide one molecule of water any smaller and still have it behave like water. Instead, it would behave like oxygen and hydrogen, its component atoms. The first type of bonding we'll look at is covalent bonding. In a covalent bond, each atom gets a full valence electron shell by sharing electrons. Each atom shares one or more of its own electrons. You can think about it as those shared electrons orbiting between both atoms, keeping the two atoms together. For example, think about methane. Methane is a gas that is made up of a carbon atom covalently bonded to four hydrogen atoms. Remember from the last tutorial that we can use the periodic table to see how many electrons an atom needs to gain or lose in order to have a full valence electron shell. Carbon has four valence electrons, so it needs four more electrons to fill its shell. In this tutorial, I'll use Lewis dot structures to draw atoms, which show only an atom's valence electrons. So a Lewis dot structure of carbon looks like this. Each hydrogen atom has one valence electron, so each hydrogen needs one more electron to fill its shell. If carbon shares each of its valence electrons with a hydrogen atom, and each hydrogen atom shares its valence electron with carbon, then all atoms end up with a full valence electron shell. The brown electrons from the hydrogens count toward the carbon's valence electron shell because they're shared with carbon. And the blue electrons from carbon count toward the hydrogen valence electron shells because they're shared with hydrogen. So all atoms have a full valence electron shell, and this is most stable. Covalent bonds are strong because those shared electrons tie the atoms together. When each atom contributes one of its own electrons, so that two total electrons are shared between the atoms, that's a single covalent bond. The bonds between carbon and each hydrogen atom in methane are single covalent bonds. A line between two atoms indicates a single covalent bond. If each atom contributes two electrons, so that four electrons are shared between the atoms, that's a double covalent bond. And if each atom contributes three electrons, so that six electrons total are shared, that's a triple covalent bond. For the same two atoms involved, as the number of shared electrons increases, bond strength increases as well. So triple bonds are stronger than single bonds. There's a subcategory of covalent bonds called polar covalent bonds. This is a type of covalent bond where the electrons are shared unequally between the atoms. This is because one atom attracts electrons more than the other atom. Think back to the last tutorial. What's the term for how much an atom attracts electrons? Electronegativity. When the two atoms involved in the covalent bond have slightly different electronegativities, the result is a polar covalent bond. A very common example of a molecule with polar covalent bonds is water. Water is made up of an oxygen atom covalently bonded to two hydrogen atoms. Oxygen has six valence electrons, so it needs two more electrons to have a full valence shell. A Lewis dot structure of oxygen looks like this. Each hydrogen has one valence electron and needs one more electron to have a full valence shell. Oxygen forms covalent bonds with each hydrogen so that all atoms have a full valence electron shell and maximum stability. But oxygen is more electronegative than hydrogen is. Oxygen attracts electrons more than hydrogen does. Shared electrons spend more time around the more electronegative atom. So these shared electrons between oxygen and hydrogen spend more time around oxygen than they do around hydrogen. With this extra negative charge, oxygen becomes partially negative, while the hydrogens are partially positive. This Greek letter, lowercase delta, means partial. In biology, polar covalent bonds are common between hydrogen and oxygen, hydrogen and nitrogen, carbon and oxygen, and carbon and nitrogen. The pairs of atoms in these bonds have different electronegativities that lead to unequal electron sharing, and thus partial charges on the atoms forming the polar covalent bond. Remember that a line between atoms indicates a single covalent bond. Let's compare the bonds in water with the bonds in methane. While oxygen and hydrogen have slightly different electronegativities, carbon and hydrogen have very similar electronegativities. So electron sharing between carbon and hydrogen in methane is pretty equal. Carbon-hydrogen covalent bonds are nonpolar covalent bonds that are commonly seen in biology. The other major type of bond is an ionic bond. Let's start with an example, table salt, made of sodium and chlorine. Take sodium. Sodium is in the left column of the periodic table and has one electron in its valence shell. So a Lewis dot structure of sodium looks like this. Losing that electron would result in a full valence shell. The electron that was lost was in this third electron shell, but without that electron, sodium's second electron shell is full. A Lewis dot structure of sodium after losing that electron looks like this. Now, sodium has more protons than electrons, more positive charge than negative charge, so overall it's positively charged. Any charged atom or molecule is called an ion, and a positively charged ion is a cation. Now let's look at chlorine. Neutral chlorine has 7 electrons in its valence electron shell. A Lewis dot structure of chlorine looks like this. Gaining one more electron would result in a full valence electron shell. A Lewis dot structure of chlorine after gaining that electron looks like this. Chloride now has more electrons than protons, more negative charge than positive charge, so it's a negatively charged ion, or anion. So what happens is electron transfer. Sodium transfers one electron to chlorine, resulting in a sodium cation and a chloride anion, both of which have full valence electron shells. These charged ions are now attracted to each other like a magnet, because positive attracts negative, and this attraction is the ionic bond. We can go back up and write a definition for an ionic bond as the attraction between a cation and an anion, and that cation and anion were formed through electron transfer. This is the type of bond found in acids, bases, and salts. Ionic and covalent bonds are the strongest types of bonds because they allow atoms to achieve a full valence electron shell and thus maximum stability. However, there are other, weaker types of bonds that are common in biology but don't fill valence electron shells. One major example is the hydrogen bond. Hydrogen bonds are plus-minus interactions between two atoms. These bonds are commonly seen between two different water molecules. In one water molecule, there's a partially positive hydrogen atom, which is partially positive because of a polar covalent bond to a more electronegative oxygen atom. The partially positive hydrogen is attracted to the partially negative oxygen from a neighboring water molecule. The plus-minus attraction between this partially positive hydrogen and this partially negative oxygen is an example of a hydrogen bond. Hydrogen bonds aren't only between hydrogen and oxygen. They're seen between a partially positive hydrogen and a variety of partially negative atoms. Let's finish this tutorial by reviewing bond strength. Hydrogen bonds are weaker than covalent bonds because hydrogen bonds are simply the attraction between partial charges, whereas the shared electrons of covalent bonds gives them their strength. Remember that single covalent bonds are weaker than double, which are weaker than triple. As solids, ionic bonds could be stronger or weaker than covalent bonds, depending on the structure. In solution, dissolved in a liquid, as found in the body, ionic bonds have interesting properties that we'll see in the next tutorial.